Welcome to Peter and Ruffy's Sportsweek here on STV. The main talking points on tonight's programme: Celtic on the verge of a title party, Caixinha hoping to appoint a local coach to his backroom team next week, and the draw has been made for the quarterfinals of both the Champions and the Europa League. Yeah, just a few of the talking points on tonight's extended programme on a Friday. Alan Ruff is alongside me, Peter Martin, and as ever on a Friday, our bookroom guest is Hugh McDonald of the Daily Mail. So, lots to talk about, lots to get into as well. Let's start with Rangers against Hamilton Accies, because Pedro Caixinha has had a look at a few of the players. He's also mentioned that he's going to appoint a number three next week, somebody local. We don't yet know who that is, Hugh.
No, we don't. So just when we don't know, we'll just make it up as we go along. I think it'll be the usual suspects. He's talking about, he's narrowed it down. It's got to be somebody that knows the club. It's got to be a local. So you're talking about ex-player. What are you talking about? Barry Ferguson, Alec Ray, maybe. I would throw in Lee McCulloch into that as well, because just simply because nothing as yet is happening at Kilmarnock. And I don't know who else.
Well, you've got Mark Haley, who is an ambassador of the club, who's there day to day. You know, he's got a proven track record. They must know what Scottish football is all about. But there will be somebody who'll come out of left field. But again, we're just throwing names in there. But we had Barry in the show, and I think Barry would be a good candidate. And I think Barry has Rangers through and through, and that's what they want, and it's somebody I would like to think that the fans could relate to.
Over and above that, Alex McLeish has come out and said he would consider director of football if it was offered.
And why not? I mean, he's apart from anything else, he's unemployed. I don't know if it would be the fit for Alex. I really don't. I still think he'd be probably happier coaching. The funny thing about director of football was that it was seen at one time as completely and utterly crucial that this was the first block to get into place.
Yeah.
And then it became, well, do you know what, we'll get a manager in first. And then they're going, well, do you know what, maybe somewhere down the line. It's almost as if it's slipping.
Yeah.
Away into the long grass.
I think it would have fallen into place had Ross Wilson kicked in and said, "I'm taking the job." And then after that, you go to Plan B, and then after that, you forget about what you first said.
Yeah.
But the priority, I think, always has to be get somebody in who's going to get the team consistently playing all the way to the end of the season. And with that in mind, it's a perfect game for him to start. I mean, Ruffy, Hamilton Accies, they've taken six off them already, and Hamilton Accies have shipped 10 goals in two games.
Yeah, but I have to say, in the last game, I think Martin Cannon, when we hear his interview, I don't think it was a 6-0. I think there were certain circumstances in that game, would have made it not 6-0. But they'll have to do better defensively. They'll have to go there and be organised. And you would have to say at the end of the day that Rangers will, score a goal. And then Hamilton obviously have to decide what they're going to do. And if they open up, then you would think, I was impressed with Rangers last week with their attitude. I think that it depends again when that first goal goes in.
Yeah, I think that's crucial, the first goal.
Yeah, and with that in mind, just in case you didn't know anything about Martin Canning of Hamilton Accies, the Rangers manager's been reading up on him.
So we always make a deep search regarding to analyse the opponents. We know that Martin Canning played until 2015, January in 2015. He was a former defender. He started like a player caretaker, something like that. And we know also they are in the 11th position with 24 points now. We know that they lost four of the last five matches, but they play all those matches away. They win against Aberdeen. And we also know that the most chances or scoring chances that they have is by a counter-attack or offensive transition, so as from the set pieces.
He's got a dossier on you as well, Ruffy, so you just have to curtail going out in the town. That's all I'm telling you.
Yeah, I could see him just sort of glancing down there.
Siri, tell me about Martin Canning.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think, listen, at the end of the day, I take on board what he said about football is, you know, there's an international language. Mm. You know, you played with a ball. It's not overcomplicated here. The only thing that he'll probably struggle to come to terms with is the nature of our game at times. You know, that's the only thing that he'll that'll maybe catch him by surprise.
Yeah, that's why you know it's really important to have somebody on board who knows. It's simple things like you know, Wim Jansen did it when he got Murdo McLeod. It's simple things like, you know, where is Pittodrie? Yeah. How far is it to go up there? You know, what do we, you know, do we need an overnight? You know, things like, what is Hamilton? Oh, Hamilton's a plastic. But, you know, people can tell you things that we all know because we've been brought up in that culture.
Yeah.
I think he's been smashing since he's come in. He's played to the, he's pressed the right buttons with the supporters, but, yeah, you know, he's been briefed on that, and he's pressed, you know, greatest club and uninterrupted history and all that, pressing the right buttons there. That press conference was all about him saying to everybody out there, I'm not just walking into this job and saying I know everything. I do my research.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a thorough professional, and this is what I do. So good on him.
Yeah, absolutely. And Kenny Miller's certainly been talking about the early part of his training regime midweek.
He's putting his own methods across. I feel the international break has come at a good time for us as well. We'll have a couple of weeks to get right down to work, and he can get his principles of how we want to play across, because we've tried that, we've been working a lot on that this week. Slight differences in how he sees the game, so it's important we get with that quickly, because obviously when you do these kind of things mid-season, it's important that you hit the ground running. So like I say, his international break, that 2 weeks will be crucial for us to getting down to work and understanding the way he wants us to work.
OK, that's it from a Rangers perspective. From a Hamilton Accies perspective here, you know, there's a Highland Derby to think about with Inverness and Ross County. Hamilton will be looking closely at that and thinking, got to try and take something from this. Every point now is a prisoner to Accies, I think.
Yeah, I think everybody down there at that precise moment needs to hang on to what they've got. That when the split comes, 15 points up for grab, you need to be in touch with somebody. You can't let them go away. You can't hope to win 3 out of 5. You've got to just make it. If it's 3 points, and then the first game you get is against the person that's above you, and then it cancels itself out if you win.
And of course, Martin Canning, well aware of the 6-0 hiding they suffered from Rangers. He'll not be hoping for a repeat of that, let me tell you.
The atmosphere will be intense as well with the new manager coming in. It'll be similar to the opening game of the season. I think it'll be a big crowd, a big atmosphere. The players will be desperate to go and impress and do well, so we need to make sure that we stand up to that, we defend properly, we're organised, we concentrate, and don't let them hurt us through a lack of concentration, which is what happened in the game the last time. If you look back at it, we played very well for large parts of that game. Obviously, decisions went against us within the game, and lapses in concentration from individuals within the game means that we end up losing the game more heavily than we should have. It was never a 6-0, so we need to make sure for us that the concentration levels are high and discipline's good, and there's no reason why we can't go there and get a result.
Okay, that's Rangers against Hamilton Accies. Here's some of the back pages, just in case you've missed some of the main stories there, and I think the main line there, cross me and I'm the devil, I think, basically Kashinya reading the riot act and saying, look, this is what I want you to do, do not go against my wishes.
Yeah, most new managers come in, lay the ground rules, and that's what he's doing. You know, he's obviously, all modern day managers are perfectionists now. You have to be there in time, you have to eat properly, do everything they say. And yes, once the message you get through, the first thing is you want to be in the first team, and if you don't do what you're told, then you're not going to be in it.
Yeah, and one other wee story there that I picked up was Mark McGee's picked up a 6-game touchline ban. It won't bother him at the moment, but if he comes back to the SPFL, then he won't be in the dugout.
Yeah, and it's a tough one because if you know, it's bad enough having a touchline ban when you're working with a club, you know. But imagine being appointed to the club and saying, well, the first thing, Mr. Chairman, is I'll not be able to be in the dugout for 6 weeks. Yeah. You know, it's quite a nasty one that way, I think, for Mark, you know. But having said that, he did have a few incidents. But I think it's a tough one when you're looking for a job and have to come back in, and then you have to turn around and say, well, I can't be in the dugout for 6 games.
I don't think it's that much of a deal breaker, though, to be honest with you. You tell the players what to do, and if they can't do it, you know.
And would that carry on if he went down to England?
No.
No.
No, it's up here.
Well, there you go. Might not affect him.
Yeah, okay. Well, there you are. That's good news for him. I'll phone him and tell him that, Ruffy, now that you've just alleviated the pain from a six-game touchline ban. You never know.
Well, I think if he's waiting for a job up here, he'll be waiting a wee while.
Right, okay.
That's
a welcome bonus for his weekend, Ruffy. You've really put the boot in there. Okay, Ruffy's in that type of mood, so just in case you thought he was going to be nice to anybody, that's not going to happen. Listen, we're going to be talking other football, and we thought we'd give you a wee question to get you through the break, see if you know the answer. Get that one, Ruffy?
No, I didn't. I thought it'd be more than that, actually. I thought it'd be up about 12, 13, something like that.
I thought it was fewer.
Yeah. Did you?
Yeah.
And 18 games. There you have it. That's Chris Boyd. Did you get that one right? Let's move on to Aberdeen against Hearts. Of course, there's a permutation that will offer Celtic the chance to win the title at Dens Park on the Sunday. Aberdeen would have to lose against Heart of Midlothian. It's going to be a humdinger of a game. Really looking forward to this one. And of course, Aberdeen are chasing a record of 9 wins, consecutive ones at home, to beat Fergie's record from 85-86 season. Stats and records can spin a wonderful tale. I'm not quite sure, no disrespect to Aberdeen, but they're not in the same league as the 85-86 side, and neither are the teams that they played.
No, I mean, it's just a completely different landscape, and all disrespect to them. I'm quite happy to be disrespectful. I mean, it's you know, to go off on a wee tangent here, I was laughing when somebody had tweeted once that if McLeish and Miller had been, you know, still playing, you know, had been playing, that Aberdeen would have won the league last year. And I said, if McLeish and Miller, even at the age they are, had played for Aberdeen last year, they would have won the league. I think people forget just how good these players were. I mean, these players went to arenas and beat Bayern Munich and went to cup finals, beat Real Madrid. I mean, these were really serious players. I mean, these were the best players in Europe. So we're nowhere near that. But that was me just going on a wee bit of nostalgic rant. But I don't expect Aberdeen to get beat tomorrow. There you go. I think that there is a possibility of a draw. But I think Aberdeen will be strong enough to withstand Hearts tomorrow, certainly to the extent of not making matters at Dens Park crucial in a title race.
Yeah, there's talk about Derek McInnes sitting down with Stuart Milne to chat about a new contract. Of course, I wonder how much the delay over the new stadium will affect any contract talks they have. But Derek McInnes read the story, quite happy to sit down and talk about an extension.
Just been told about the chairman's comments this morning. I was speaking to him yesterday as well, and he never mentioned it. So it's nice to know he wants me to hang about. You know, we're really keen to try and finish the season strong. So, you know, if that's what the chairman's wish is to talk about that, then happy to sit down and talk to him and see. But we've got a lot of challenges ahead of us at the minute. You know, the chairman's busy trying to drive home the training ground in the stadium, and I'm busy trying to drive home performances on the pitch. So I'm sure we'll get round to talk about that in the future.
Yeah, there you are. Well worthy of the deal, Ruffy?
Yeah, I think so. I think although that he'll want to be part of this new stadium, the new training complex, I think he's enjoying himself up there. I think,
and the chairman loves him as well.
And I would like to think the fans love him as well. He's still got a chance, you know, to get to another cup final. And I just think that it's a good place to be. I think he's found somewhere that, you know, he's happy. Obviously, he was mentioned for the Rangers job. Whether he would have taken it or not is another matter if he'd been asked it. But I just think there's things happening up in Aberdeen. But as Peter said, this stadium is the bigger picture.
No. I think with Derek is happy there. I mean, but I would imagine it's not the limit of his ambitions. I mean, he'd look to go back down to England at one point, I would think, you know, after the Bristol experience, which didn't turn out well. I actually have no reason to say this, but my gut feeling is that he would have taken the Rangers job. I just feel he would have. But he's well loved in Aberdeen. There's a, you know, that great modern word, the project. The project's going fine. I think he should have maybe did more with in relation to Ronnie Dyla's team.
Yeah.
I always feel that was a big opportunity missed. And I feel that one cup under Derek is great, but could possibly mean more in an era where St Johnston are winning cups and Ross County and Inverness. Yeah. But I think it's well worth a new deal.
Okay, what about it from the Hearts perspective? Well, Hearts will be celebrating the fact that they've got three youngsters on new extended deals to 2020. Jack Hamilton is one of them, also John Souter and Rory Curry as well. Mm. So clearly they're planning for the future with some home-based players, which is always nice to see. Ian Cathro has been talking ahead of this game up at Pittodrie. He says this could be Hearts' toughest game of the season.
It's one of the toughest games that we'll face in this league. I think we have a good understanding of how the game will be. Of how the game will begin. I know they've had some pitch issues. You know, we can talk about that because we all know everybody's seen ours. We're going to start in a very fast paced, high energy, you know, lunchtime kickoff SPL game.
Okay, there you are. Short and sweet from Ian Cathro. Jamie Walker's targeting 20 goals. I don't think he'd be too disappointed that he was left out of the Scotland squad. I think Jamie Walker will be a Scotland player of the future, though, Ruffy.
Yeah, but he's the kind of player I would have liked to have seen in the Canada game. You know, I'd like to see him, you know, what they can do. Just give them a wee step up and then you get a wee bit a better idea of where they are in the future. But as far as Hearts are concerned, I think going up to Aberdeen, if they go behind, and Aberdeen haven't been scoring a lot of goals at home, but they've been winning 1-0, I think Hearts need to prove that they're up for a fight. I think the one thing about a Hearts team was they were always up for a fight. I remember them going up to Pittodrie and actually spoiling the game just by being up for a fight. So I think the thing that's been labelled at Hearts just now is obviously when they're not winning, they seem to down tools, so that'd be something that we want to improve in.
Yeah, here's a look at the table, because the questions to be answered, can Rangers catch Aberdeen? Can Hearts catch Rangers? And also, will St Johnston overtake Hearts? That seems to be some of the issues at the top end of the table. And then, of course, at the bottom end, Motherwell take on St Johnston with a new manager in charge. Tommy Wright, you wouldn't bet against him actually overtaking Hearts, because again, he just continues season in, season out. He is your steady Eddie.
Very much so. And by their standards, they've had a couple of disappointing results by their standards, but they're still in the top six, still outperforming budget, not outperforming expectation now, because we've come to believe that the rightful place for St Johnston is in the top six, despite budget constraints. But I mean, I think over the last 5 years to 7 years, he's been the best manager in Scotland. If you take over that, I really do.
Yeah, of course, Stephen Robinson's setting out on a new adventure as the Motherwell manager, and he gets the chance to look ahead to this game against St Johnston.
I expect a tough game, a very tough game. Tommy's got them well organised. You know, he's worked wonders with St Johnston and, you know, kept them in the top half of the table every season. He's done fantastic. So it's going to be a tough game. I don't think there'll be any surprises with how they play. They're a threat up front, and you know, they're well organised. They've got points on the board, and they're sitting, I think, a point off fourth. So it's going to be a tough game. But you know, first and foremost, we must match that energy and desire that St Johnston will come and show, and then show that we have that added quality, which maybe perhaps at times we've lacked in the last two games.
Is he enough to take Motherwell out of your tip for playoff or relegation?
Yeah, I think a new manager, you'll get a response.
Does it change your mind?
No.
Well, wait a minute then.
I'm just saying he could get a response. Yeah. But he's done what we were talking about earlier with Rangers. They've given an appointment. He knows the players. He knows the other teams, just like you were saying. So that will be his advantage. But it's okay saying they've got the two best strikers going about, but if the defence doesn't get their act together, they will be down there as well.
Yeah, well, we did show you the table at the bottom end. Another team right in the mire is Inverness Cali Thistle. It's the Highland Derby against Ross County. Suddenly from last week, Richie Foran saying they want to win ugly. Now he wants it to be nasty as well.
They've come out on top in the previous two games. I believe they've out-muscled us a wee bit, which is disappointing. I've watched the two games again. We need to be stronger. We need to be more aggressive, but fair. But we need to be up for this battle, because it's going to be a battle. Look, as I said, we need to be stronger. You know, it's nearly one of the friendliest derbies around. It's been made over the last couple of years. That's got to change the minute you walk onto that pitch. After, it's a different story. Shake hands. I know you bump into these players nearly every day. You're drinking the same coffee shops, you're eating the same restaurants. That's fine. That's okay. But out there, you must be nasty. You must be ready to battle against them. There's no friends on that park come Saturday.
I get the feeling, Hugh, in the last couple of weeks, Richie just wants a full scaler.
just wants a rammy, really. You know, he just wants. He should take a lesson from Ruffy. You know, that be nasty at work.
Yeah.
Nice guy away from it, but a nasty guy in the studio.
Yeah. Who do you think is going to win that game?
I think Ross County. If there's going to be a winner, I'd go for Ross County.
I'm Ruffy. Going for Inverness.
Okay, you see, there's that nasty streak. Can't agree with you, Hugh, just offering you an alternate opinion on that one. Okay, coming up, we're going to be talking about the Champions League. So we thought, to take you into the break, why not test your memories in the Champions League with this question. Easy for you, Hugh. You were at that game.
Yeah, but my memory now just goes away. I forgot all about it. I mean, the thing I remember from my game was just how much Barcelona. I think Fergie said after the game, we're just completely and utterly outplayed. I mean, I think that was Barcelona in their glory years lasted for a while. Don't get me wrong, but they were just untouchable at times then, weren't they?
Yeah, always difficult to pin down. The best Barcelona side, you know, when you think about it. I mean, I think I was in the final in Rome when Manchester United, Ronaldo tried to win it on his own, but in the end they lost by 2-0. But it's difficult to pin down which one is the most special. We're going to talk Champions League very shortly, but we've still got a couple of games in the Premiership. We've also got Hibs on the agenda and St Mirren. To Kilmarnock, still... no decision on the manager as yet, and Lee McCulloch quite happy to take it one game at a time.
I got a text the weekend there just to say well done, it's a great result for the Ross County game, so there's no been any chat. I think they know that I'm just happy right now with the situation, so no news can be good news, no news can be bad news, just as I've said. So I think it's day at a time and game at a time, on that old cliche, but it really is. And coming in and enjoying training and getting stuck in with the boys, and that's something that I've always enjoyed.
Yeah, well, are we just trying to rush this along? Is it quite happy? The players will be quite happy. They know him anyway.
Yeah, no, I think he's in the box seat. You know, if he keeps winning games and takes them away, but I think again it depends on who the list of candidates are. You know, they're saying there's 30, 40 candidates. Sometimes a candidate that's in there might just be the one that the directors fancy a name or fancy somebody who's got a track record. But as it stands just now, I think Lee's got everything going for him, as long as he keeps winning games.
And it's not a crisis situation at the moment. It's not like, you know, they're bottom of the league or they're in free fall. They're actually doing okay. And you know, so that'll take a bit of the pressure off. I would imagine if they were losing every week and they were last in the league, and they might be... That would concentrate the minds wonderfully, as they say.
Yeah. Is there an added bonus or any benefit in the fact that Alan Archibald's only had about 9 fit players training this week, Ruff? He's got a lot of injuries.
Yeah, he certainly has. You know, I'd still be disappointed after that late goal last week. But he'll be hoping that, obviously, he's given them a bit of rest, that they'll come back, you know, and he'll get as near as his best 11 as possible, because they're in a healthy state just now. But I think he knows... that, you know, a couple of defeats, you know, you're back in the mire again. But so they'll be hoping they can pick up something.
No emergency loan for you? No phone calls from the Alan Ruff suite?
No, I don't think that's ever going to happen.
No. Okay. Still playing sport though, Ruffy, which is good. We don't want you just to shut down completely. We still want you playing some kind of sport. The other thing I was going to say to you guys with regards to the fixtures, Saturday afternoon, Hugh will be here, so will Gordon Smith and Alan Ruff, and we will look over those five games in the Premiership. And then, as you can see there from the fixtures, Aberdeen Hearts is the early kick-off. It's Inverness against Ross County, Kilmarnock, Partick Thistle, Motherwell, St Johnstone, Rangers, Hamilton, and then Dundee against Celtic, 12:30 on the Sunday. Chris Davis speaking earlier today said, you know, the manager definitely doesn't want the players to take their foot off the gas. There's two things they're going for. They want the treble, so they want to win the Scottish Cup. They also, I think, a driving force for them is to create a little bit of history as going through the entire season undefeated, Hugh.
I think so. And one of the things... I thought they were disappointing last week against Rangers by their own standards, but generally this season, in fact, not generally, every game this season they went to the last minute. I mean, I've watched games where they've been 1-2 up, but they haven't taken the foot off the pedal, especially away from home, and they've gone on to win 3-4, 4-0. So the actual commitment and the sort of consistent application of the players has been excellent. Last week, I just thought, I've got a sort of view on it that the park doesn't help Celtic at the moment. Celtic Park doesn't help them at the moment. I think that was a factor against them. Also,
I think so.
Yeah, honestly think yeah. so. I think the park, the ball, they'd like to pass the ball a lot quicker than that. I think Rangers' game plan was great. I mean, you just look at the Rangers' game plan and say, I mean, what was Mark Warburton thinking for three games? We all were saying before Rangers-Celtic games, like, he would have to do this and he would have to do that, and he never did. Graham Murty, to his credit, said, no, this is the way I'm going to play, I'm not going to learn it, and it worked.
Yeah.
And a couple of the main Celtic players didn't play on the day. I mean, I think the best player in Scotland at the moment is Scott Sinclair, and he definitely didn't play on the day. Dembele was weaker than usual. But I think after a week, I think they'll get back to it, and... Dundee will be difficult. Last time when they went up to Dundee, I think it was a Scott Brown goal, wasn't it, that made the difference. So it was a tough match, and I expect a tough match again. But if you're asking me about invincibility, I think they'll still be unbeaten by Sunday night.
Yeah, I think they'll be unbeaten by Sunday night. I do think, obviously, as we spoke about them, you know, as the season goes on week, that there was a tiredness last week. I thought there was a sluggishness at the Rangers game. Again, don't take any away for Rangers. I thought Rangers were superb. But I just think as the season goes on and an away trip to Aberdeen, you know, something might go amiss, but we all like to see records, you know. So I think the majority of neutrals will be hoping that they get some kind of record.
Yeah, the Dundee boss Paul Hartley will be hoping he can maybe shatter that record. This is his take on the game.
It's an atmosphere. The pitch is incredible. So we've got to make sure that we start really well. We're bright. We're on the front foot. We pass the ball properly, and try and cause Celtic problems. Yeah, we have to make sure that the total focus is on how we can get a result against Celtic. The results on Saturday are out with our hands, but we've got to, you know, have that game plan in our head, to play at our best, to perform on the pitch, to try and get the result that for this football club.
Yeah, they've lost their way a wee bit over the last couple of games, though, just when maybe Paul was hoping they'd make a surge for that sixth place.
Yeah. But just to stop, we've got to stop for a minute and say, like, that clip from Paul Hartley every week is just my highlight of my week. Just wait for that every week. Just sitting
there. To see the bonnet,
the wee face. I just love that. Yeah, they have slipped a bit, but from... there have been an inconsistency in Dundee all season, to be fair, but the inconsistency at least is in a different position in the league than it was at one time. Remember, they were anchored at the bottom. I think they're capable of good performances. I think there's players in the team that are of a good quality. I think this will be a tough game for Celtic. And Dundee beat Rangers cosily. Mm-hmm. So I think this will be a tough game. I expect Celtic to win. I expect them to have too much. But I don't think it's a runaway victory.
No, I think it'll be a difficult one. I think we also, you know, that when you got with Dundee, players roll their sleeves up and get about the better sides. You know, I do think Dundee would have to score first if they were going to get something out of the game. But it depends. And I think we all know that the Celtic players are going to up their game after the disappointment of last week.
Okay, we're going to delve into the Championship now, and as ever, it's getting exciting at the top end because the results just seem to be going Hibernian's way from time to time. Just when it looks as if Dundee United were going to peg them back, Dundee United slip up, lost to Hibs, and then St Mirren managed to defeat them in a five-goal thriller in midweek as well. So Hibs face Dumbarton, and their closest challengers end up being Falkirk, Ruffy.
Yeah, I think if I was Neil Lennon, I'd be just keep my eye on them. You know, 6 points seems a lot, you know, but Neil's already had a couple of games and results where nobody could see it coming. So if he can cut out that, you know, I think they will run away with it. But I think Falkirk will be... You want to keep your eye on them.
Well, the word coming out of Easter Road, similar to Celtic, Neil Lennon saying he doesn't want the team to take their foot off the gas. And Hibs player Darren McGregor is hoping the end of the season is going to be yet again another special one for Hibs.
Like Hibs, you're expected to be in the mix. I mean, I think the last couple of years have been very disappointing the way we've went about our business and the way we've lost, but I mean, we're here to make up for it this year, and I think this year's massive. And as I say, at the start of the season, if we'd have given us this points difference with that many games to go, we'd have taken it. So we're in a great position, but one that we can't get complacent with, and we obviously know there's still plenty of hard work between now and the end of the season, so it's up to us to keep the levels of consistency up. I mean, it'd be great to go into the Aberdeen game knowing that we've got the league in the bag. That'd be unbelievable. But as I say, words are cheap. I think our actions speak louder. But that'll take care of itself when we arrive to that. But it could be a special season. You're right.
Could be a humdinger again. I mean, Scottish Cup, fantastic. Never to be forgotten. They could be back in the final, and I think the ultimate for them this time is just briefly the league title in the bag.
It has to be league titles. You could have an argument last year, you know, given the length they hadn't won a cup. League titles, absolutely vital.
Okay, there you are. He's hit the nail on the head, Hugh McDonald. After the break, we'll continue to look at the Championship. We'll look at the other leagues as well in Scotland. Then we'll look at the draw that's been made earlier today for the Champions League and the Europa League as well. Only one English team in the Champions League. And who would have put a bet on it being Leicester City? We'll talk about that right after this quick break. Welcome back to Peter and Ruffy's Sports Week. Alan Ruff and Hugh McDonald are alongside me, Peter Martin. Tomorrow we'll be on air at 2 o'clock. If you get the chance to join us, we'll keep you up to date with all the goals as they hit the back of the nets, and no shortage of, beg your pardon, opinion and interview as well. So from Hibs against Dumbarton, let's look at the chasing pack. Falkirk Morton is just the cracker for me. In that division tomorrow, I think you'd struggle to get a better game than that one.
I think Aberdeen Hearts is smashing, but that comes close for me because of the, you know, everything that's involved in it. You know, you're now talking about, I think Dundee United have been so almost dire in the last few weeks that the second place is up for grabs, and the second place is important because when it comes to playoffs, it gets you 2 games fewer. You know. I've been talking to a few guys in the Championship this week, and they've told me that they really believe that Falkirk are coming strong. That Peter Houston knows the ground, has been a course and distance winner in that respect. But I think that's a smashing match tomorrow.
Strangely enough, I'm gonna back Morton, Ruffy, but just. They're unbeaten in the last 3 games, but when you look at the scalps, you know, along the way and the teams, I mean, they drew with Falkirk at Capello, also Dundee United at Tannadice, and defeated Queen of the South. So, I mean, we say it week in, week out about Duff's side. They're just well organised, but they've got some very talented boys playing for them.
Yeah, and you're right. I would think they're the surprise team of the Championship. I don't even think Jim would have thought they'd been good enough to get in the playoffs, but they are, and they've justified being in there. I think they're in there because of the good cup run that they had and the games that they've had. The players have got confidence now, are playing big games, more and more experience they get. And I think we all hope that they stay in the playoffs. I think they will stay in the playoffs because I think they'll add something to it. But as you said, it's just... thing mean for where you're going to finish, because two games less is a big bonus if you don't have to play them.
Yeah, and there are two games that are so inextricably linked that defies belief. But Dunfermline at home to Ayr United. Ian McCaug is back to his old club, desperately needing something, because the Great Escape theme, as I mentioned to Stephen McGinn, is kicking in again for St Mirren. Jack Ross has got them biting at the tail of Ayr United and Raith Rovers.
Yeah, and I think that was a huge result in midweek. You know, having that game in hand, it means nothing unless you capitalise on it, and they've done that. I think Ayr United are in a bit of a kind of doldrums, you know, in terms of points. They're playing well and not getting there. They're beaten by Falkirk, but as I understand it, it was because, you know, the margin was because Ayr United threw so much into it to get something out of it at the end. I think there's still plenty of spirit about Ayr United. I think there's plenty of quality. I like the manager. I think he's a good manager. But I think this is a smashing game tomorrow again. The Championship just throws them up, because Alan Johnson's Dunfermline are really good to watch and play great football. But I agree with you, tomorrow Ayr will definitely be looking at getting something out of that game.
Yeah, Stephen McGinn was on the show yesterday. No surprise, he reckons the confidence is there to escape relegation.
We won at Ayr, we've really believed. And now we've just beaten Dundee United after beating Hibs, so we're playing really well at the minute, and I think we're second in the form table at the minute in the league as well. So the teams above us won't be looking forward to us coming, and we've got it back to within a point. We said coming through such a punishing schedule, we've been playing Saturday, Wednesday, and if we could get in, keep in with the pack, coming off the back of next week's cup final, then we'll be giving ourselves a right chance.
Yeah, we've got goal scorers in there. Mm-hmm. He's in there with Stevie Mallon as well.
They're
a totally different side.
Yeah, I had great hesitation about picking them to come out of that slump, because for all the good talk about them, they just weren't getting the results. And then after a while you say, well, it really is put up or shut up time. Now, the last few weeks, they've turned that around a wee bit. I think there's a bit of momentum there. There is quality there. I think the team... One of the teams, you know, I think, keep an eye on Raith Rovers. Raith Rovers' form has been really poor, and I think they're far from being out of it either.
Yeah, I think it's a difficult one, but I mean, obviously everybody will be looking at the fixtures for tomorrow, but I think St Mirren's fixtures are Dumbarton and Ayr coming up back to back. I think the three teams know how important these games are going to be, and you have to say, whichever one of them takes 6 points out of that are the ones that are going to be safe.
Yeah, Ruffy, one win in 19 for Raith Rovers. I mean, it's absolutely dire.
Yeah, and I mean, confidence is low. It's low, you know, and you don't get the breaks, you know, and everything goes against you. And if you don't get, you might be winning 1-0 a minute ago, and you lose two goals, and you think everybody is just against you. And that's the way they've been for a long, long time now. So the sooner they turn that around, the better for them.
Yeah, okay, we'll keep our eye on the Championship. It's going to be nip and tuck, top and bottom. Here's the fixtures for Saturday afternoon: Dunfermline, Ayr United, Hibs, Dumbarton, Queen of the South against St Mirren, Raith Rovers, Dundee United, and of course the evening one at 5:15, Falkirk against Morton. As far as League One is concerned tomorrow, this is what we have on offer: Airdrie against Stenhouse Muir, Albion Rovers versus Peterhead, East Fife, Alloa, Queen's Park against Brechin City, and Stranraer against Livingston. And in League Two, Berwick Rangers are both, Clyde against Edinburgh City, Cowdenbeath against Montrose, Elgin City against Forfar, and Stirling Albion against Annan Athletic. Incidentally, it would be nice to see Derek Riordan have a nice finish to his career. If he gets a couple of years out of Edinburgh City, it would be great.
That's a huge game tomorrow. Absolutely huge game. See, historically, Clyde are in free fall in that division. They could end up being in that, you know, that bottom spot.
Yeah.
It really could. They're a bit like Raith Rovers as far as plummeting, and it's going to be... That's a huge game tomorrow, because with Craig Beattie and Riordan up front, Edinburgh City have turned it around a bit, and they're picking up points. So for people who are, you know, have got the history of the Bully Wee at heart, this is a crucial end to a season.
Yeah, absolutely. I always really start to get interested in the Champions League at the business end of the season, and this is us heading into it now. The quarterfinal draw has been made. Here's how it all looks. In the last eight, Atletico Madrid against Leicester, Borussia Dortmund against Monaco, Bayern Munich against Real Madrid, and Juventus against Barcelona is a humdinger. Let's talk about the Champions League first of all, Hugh. I only want to talk to you about it because we are the only two with teams left in it. There's no point in relating to Ruffy because he doesn't really know that much about it. But Juventus against Barcelona, that is an absolute cracker. And your team, Dortmund?
Yeah, Dortmund. I think Dortmund and Monaco will be a smashing game because they're both teams that like to be on the front foot and attack. I think Monaco in many ways will suit Dortmund because Dortmund are very good countering. But I don't think the winner of the tournament's going to come from that tie, obviously. Yeah. I mean, I think the bottom end of the draw, it's just, I mean, astonishingly
I'm
good.
Going to say something shocking to you. I've got Barcelona to win it, Ruffy, but I don't think it's clear-cut. I actually think they are not as good a side as Barcelona teams of old. I mean, I think they could come a cropper. Yeah.
Especially against Juve. You know, we all know the Italian teams are absolute experts. You know, if they can hang on to anything, they'll hang on to it. And you wouldn't think that, just say for talking sake, Juve were winning one goal or two goal. You wouldn't think they're going to lose six goals the way the
last... Can you see Juventus knocking Barcelona out, Robert?
I think it'll be tight. I think it'll be really, really tight.
I didn't ask you that. Can you
yes,
see
I hope they stuff them.
Yeah, okay. To all my Italian friends, I apologise. Ruffy has backed Juventus. Get your money on Barcelona big time. Now, the Europa League, I'm not a fan. I'm not going to hide it. Here's the draw. I think Jose Mourinho has put all his eggs in the basket and said, this is our passage to the Champions League.
And why not? Because the Champions League's huge. Now, if you look at that top, the six putatively going for four places in England, I think Chelsea certainly got it. I'd be surprised if Manchester City, even in the doldrums, didn't get one. And I'd be surprised if Spurs didn't get one. So there's one up for grabs between Arsenal, Man United and Liverpool. So it's going to be tight.
Tottenham?
I think Tottenham will definitely. Yeah. Tottenham would be one of my three that will get it. The Europa League is really offering Manchester United something. I think they'll win it.
You think they'll win it?
I think they'll win
Ruffy?
It.
Yes, I think they'll win it as well.
Okay. Get your money on Anderlecht.
The black spot.
They're going out. It's as simple as that. Listen, it's been an absolute joy to have Hugh with us here on a Friday as ever. He'll be back with us tomorrow. Hopefully you can join us 2 o'clock till six. Bit of banter, no shortage of interviews as well. Goals hitting the back of the net. We'll keep you up to date with that. Reporters out at grounds. Gordon Smith will be joining us as well to add a little factual insight and history to the show as well. If anybody gets their facts wrong, Gordon is usually all over us. It's as simple as that. Thanks once again to Hugh McDonald. Join us on STV at 2 o'clock tomorrow for the Saturday Football Show. From Ruffy, Hugh and myself, Peter, thanks for watching. Good night.